Richard Lau.
Yo, yo, what's up, guys?
What's up, guys? I got my bro Richard Lau on the phone. Richard Lau is a extremely talented, just tech wizard, as well as video production creative based out of New York, Long Island specifically. And I actually asked him to come on the channel because what he knows is he knows what we know on the surface level as far as computers, but he just goes so much deeper. We spend so much time on our computers video editing, most of us. I basically live here. And we kind of know kind of the basics regarding, you know, what goes into making the perfect editing PC. But I promise this video is going to go so much deeper and show you everything that goes into constructing the perfect editing PC. Notice we didn't say Mac. Right now we're PC people, right? Right, Richard?
That's right. Yep, yes, sir.
For good reasons. So shout out to all you Mac people. You know, hopefully this video can convert you. But even if you aren't a Mac, this will interest you, this video. So building a PC is the perfect thing to do, in my opinion. I think Richard would agree. But in order to build the perfect PC, you got to know what to do. So stay tuned. This video is going to be amazing. But first, of course, we're going to talk about Envato Elements. If you're watching this video, you're probably a video editor, and Envato Elements is a video editor's dream. It's a subscription service that gives you unlimited downloads of the most incredible stock footage, like cloud and fog overlays, aerial footage, fire, lightning. They also have incredible VFX packs, Premiere and After Effects templates, sound effects, royalty-free music, and literally anything you could ever want as a video editor. Just by clicking the link below, you will automatically get a free first month. You'll see that coupon for the free first month at the very, very end after you've finished signing up. And that's it. I use Elements literally in some regard every day. All right, Richard, the floor is yours.
Yo, what's going on, lovely humans of the internet? My name is Richard. I am a content creator based in New York. And in this video today, I'm going to be doing a PC build guide for video editors of all budgets. I'm going to be walking you through a variety of different components and helping you choose which parts are best for your fit. So without further ado, let's just jump right into it. So the first thing is the processor. This is going to be the most important aspect. This is pretty much the brain of the computer, and it's going to be doing most of the work of rendering, editing, everything like that. There are two main brands out there, Intel and AMD, and they also serve very different purposes. AMD typically offers better onboard graphics, which makes it more desirable for gamers. They also have more cores for the price, meaning it's better for multi-threaded applications and multitasking. Whereas Intel, they have less cores, but each core is actually more powerful. On top of that, they're also more optimized for Adobe programs. So if you're editing with Premiere Pro, this is probably the better option. Now, I also presented this in four tiers: entry, mid, high, and ultra. And it all just comes down to the budget. If I had to give a set, you know, recommendation, it would have to be the high tier because you're getting the most bang for your buck. The reason why I don't suggest getting the ultra, which is the i9 or the Ryzen 9, is because you're paying a lot more for just a small little bit of extra performance. So it's not going to be the best for this value. Put into perspective, the high and ultra is recommended if you're going to be doing a lot of 4K editing. And I'm not saying the entry or mid-level processor can't handle 4K editing. You definitely could, but you definitely will notice a little bit of a slowdown and lag behind it. So if you do have a shorter budget and you're looking into the i3, i5, Ryzen 3, or Ryzen 5, I highly suggest using proxies if you're going to be editing 4K footage. Moving on to the next part, we have RAM. Now the purpose of RAM is it helps with multitasking or if you have multi-track edits. Now if you're editing 4K footage, I would recommend sticking with 32 gigs at the minimum, or 64 if you want to have that extra leeway. 16 gigs is a little bit pushing it if it comes to 4K footage. If you're doing 1080p, 16 gigs is more than enough. Now the bare minimum is 8. I would not suggest going lower than that. If you have the budget, I highly recommend going with the high tier yet again. The Ultra, same concept as the processor, you're going to be paying a lot more for just a slight bit of increase. And if you get too much RAM, and if you're not going to be using all of that, it just goes to waste. It's not going to improve your speed or anything. Something like 128 gigs is very unnecessary. You're not going to be using that RAM. It's just going to be sitting there. It does give you that leeway if you know, want to have like 10 programs open, but yet again, it's not necessary, and it's going to break the bank unless you have the budget and you want to go all out. But honestly, I think 32 gigs is the recommended amount for a standard build. Next up is the motherboard. There are three kinds of motherboards out there: the Mini ITX, Micro, and ATX. Now the difference between these boards is basically just its size, if you want to, you know, have a more compact build or a full-size build. With the bigger boards versus the smaller boards, there are a little bit of differences in terms of how many slots you're getting. The Mini ITX and Micro ATX boards will only have two RAM slots, whereas a full-size ATX will have four. You also only have one PCI lane, which is for graphics cards, on the Mini and Micro, whereas the ATX you can have two. And the most budget-friendly option here is the Micro ATX, as it provides everything that you need. And if you want to have a future-proofing option, I definitely recommend getting a full-size ATX board. I don't recommend getting a Mini ITX, as cooling might be an issue, but that is if you really, really want a compact, small, tiny build. And the mini boards also cost a lot, so I don't recommend getting that. For the price of a Mini ITX board, you can definitely get a pretty high-end ATX full-size board. The easiest way to choose which board is best for you is to see how fast your RAM is. Make sure you choose a board that can support your RAM speed. Try not to bottleneck it by getting something that's slower than what your RAM can handle. And higher end boards also have better cooling and stuff like that. Moving on to the next part is the graphics cards. Now, this is not as important as some people think. When it comes to gaming, obviously you want to get the best of the best, but if you're not gaming and you're strictly sticking with editing, it's only going to help render previews and help with smoother playbacks. And there are two main manufacturers, which is Nvidia and AMD. Now, there are also a lot of companies that carry these cards like MSI, you know, EVGA, but the card itself is still the same. And as a matter of fact, these entry level graphics cards are pretty equivalent to the graphics cards that are built into MacBooks. So that is a little bit of an idea of how the performance level is. If you're working with really big files, I do recommend getting something that's a little higher tier, like the higher Ultra. But we're doing like 1080p, 4K, you know, YouTube stuff. Entry or mid-level is more than enough. Now, if you're looking for the bang for your buck option, yet again, I recommend the high tier as you're going to be paying a decent amount of price for a lot of performance. Moving on to storage, there are three options. There is a NVMe M.2 SSD, SATA SSDs, as well as hard drives. This is ordered from the fastest to the slowest, also the most expensive to the cheapest. Now, if you have the budget, I highly recommend getting an NVMe SSD as your OS main drive. This is going to make everything run so much faster, startup time, loading time, everything. And when you're editing, I highly suggest using a separate drive to use as a scratch disk instead of editing off the main OS drive. Editing on the drive where your OS and programs are installed on will also slow down the performance, and it also puts a lot of wear and tear on the drive by reading and writing on it all the time. So for the scratch disk, if you could, I do recommend getting a second NVMe drive, but if not, sticking with the SATA option is definitely recommended. I highly don't recommend getting a traditional hard drive as your main drive, but yet again, if you're on a really tight budget and that's the only option, you can go for it. I recommend getting a hard drive as a storage option for your backups, your archives, stuff like that. The ideal situation, I would actually recommend getting each of these drives, the NVMe for the OS, the SATA for the scratch disk where you edit off of, and the HDD for your storage. Now, to power everything, you're gonna need a power supply. There are three kinds yet again. There is a non-modular, semi-modular, and modular. Now, what modular means is you can remove the cables that you don't need, so it could be a little more organized when you're doing your build. Semi-modular means some of the cables are stuck, some of them you can remove. Typically, the most important cables are gonna be stuck in there. And non-modular is the cheapest option where all the cables are stuck onto the power supply. The only purpose of this is for organization's sake. You don't want wires just dangling around all over the place. Now, in terms of the actual power, that depends on your parts. You can use PC Part Picker to put in all the parts that you want, and it'll give you an estimated power consumption. When choosing a power supply, I highly recommend finding something that is at least 80 plus certified, meaning it's going to be reliable and efficient. There is, you know, 80 plus bronze, gold, platinum, and obviously the better it is, the more it costs and has better efficiency and heat resistance. I don't suggest cheaping out on the power supply because this can either blow up, it can literally catch on fire, it can short circuit your entire build or just fail on you. So I highly don't suggest getting a cheap power supply. Think about it as this is the heart that pumps the blood to the rest of the parts. So you really shouldn't cheap out on this. Now, moving on to the case, there are three sizes. There's a mini ITX case, a mid tower, and a full tower. Now, this goes back to the beginning of the motherboard. So if you're gonna be building a really compact mini size PC, I highly suggest getting a mini ITX case. If we're going with a full-size ATX board, a mid-tower will fit it, actually. So the mid-tower is the most popular option. You know, it fits full-size ATX motherboards, can fit up to two graphics cards. It is also the most affordable options. Cases will range from $35 up to $250, $300-ish. Now, the case doesn't really affect your performance. Maybe a little bit of cooling, because some cases do have better intake and outtake fans. But this is mainly just for aesthetics. You can choose a case that you like to show off your build. So this is your way of expressing your build. And if you have the budget to get a nice, pretty case, feel free and do so. Last but definitely not least is the cooling. There are three options. There is air cooling, which is using fans only. Next, there is an AIO, which is an all-in-one, which is pretty much a combination of air and liquid. The way it works is there are fans connected to a radiator with liquid inside that cools the component that it's connected to. And then of course we have liquid cooling. If you're doing a simple build, air cooling is more than enough. You can stick with the stock cooler for the most part if you have one. If you plan on keeping everything stock, sticking with air cooling is definitely fine. Now, if you're gonna be doing a little bit of overclocking, I highly suggest getting an AIO. Now, if you're not going to be doing some crazy overclocking, you don't need a liquid cooled PC. So yeah, that is pretty much my guide for this PC build tutorial. I hope you guys enjoyed and found it helpful. I really wanted to make this guide apply for many budgets, so it's not like a set build for, you know, for a set price. If you guys enjoyed this video and you want to see more content from me, feel free to check me out on YouTube at Richard Lau. There will be a link in the description below. And shout out to Josh for letting me be on this segment of the video. And yeah, with that being said, I hope you guys will have a great day.
Richard, that was freaking amazing. I remember getting this footage. I've just been watching it, taking notes myself. There's a lot of stuff that I really actually did not know as a video production person. And I know this video spoke to a ton of people. Please make sure to follow Richard Socials are down in the description. I freaking love our channel teachers. I hope you're enjoying them too. Thanks so much for watching the video, guys. I actually have two additional videos that you've got to watch. And remember to get your free month of Envato Elements by clicking the link below in the description. And lastly, make sure to subscribe to the channel. Thanks so much for watching, guys. And as always, remember to keep it chill.